Okay, good afternoon everyone, and welcome to the Playtech Academy. We now have a presentation on bingo, evolution not revolution, the changing face of bingo, presented by Andrew Steddy, Gaming Operations Director for Playtech, and Gary Keaney, Head of Product for Playtech Bingo. If you have any questions, please save them till the end. There will be a short time after the presentation for a quick Q&A session. So without further ado, over to Andrew.
Thanks, Dave. Welcome everybody to the Playtech Academy. Gary and I are going to talk through two topics today, both of which are reflective of key trends in the current bingo market. More specifically, how Playtech are adapting to those challenges and meeting those challenges. So firstly, I'm going to give you a brief history of the rise and fall, and hopefully rise again, of the retail bingo market as we move towards an era where online and offline bingo can be fully integrated. And that's something Playtech are obviously certainly very much engaged in, as we've seen in other verticals, for instance, in retail betting with the Coral Connect project, which has been very successful. I'm going to give you, omnichannel is very much a buzzword in the industry at the moment, for very good reason. It's the theme of the stand here at ICE. There's been many talks about it already at the Academy, and as I say, for very good reason. It's not all about sort of channel and content, but a multi-channel player is far more valuable to operators. The retention of those players is far longer. And from a brand perspective as well, having that consistent message across mobiles, tablets, desktops, retail, in-club handhelds is worth its weight in gold as well. And then Gary's going to talk a bit more about the technology challenges that we're facing and how players' lifestyles and habits are changing over time as well, and how we're adapting to that. So let's go back in time. Firstly, back to the 1960s. I obviously wasn't born then. But this was a real boom day for bingo. The Betting and Gaming Act heralded the launch of the UK's first commercial bingo clubs. And admissions around this time were around 260 million a year, which put it ahead of cinema admissions and holiday camp attendance, which were the main sort of leisure activities of the day. To put that into a bit of modern day context, UK cinema admissions last year, for instance, were around the 150 million mark, so you can see how popular bingo was back then. And as we moved through the 70s and 80s, you know, bingo was still a strong industry, very healthy industry. New venues were cropping up, purpose-built destination venues were cropping up. But because of TV, other pressures, other forms of entertainment, those admission levels from the 60s were never going to be sustainable, obviously. But as I say, still a very healthy industry. And admissions around that time were around 83 million. There were around 1,400 bingo clubs in the UK, and about 8 million players were still playing bingo on a fairly regular basis. Now, bingo was moving into an era where operators were focusing heavily on customer services and marketing, but it was about to face a series of really significant challenges to the industry. Firstly, a smoking ban, obviously. An estimated 50% of bingo players were smokers. So obviously they were either going to stay away or the interval spend, you know, every time there was an interval, they would go outside and smoke, and therefore interval spend was affected. Taxation has always been a bit of a burden of the industry. Retail betting taxed at 10%. For some reason, bingo was 20%. And that was often cited as a reason why operators weren't refurbishing their large retail estates. And that was a situation only remedied in 2014, famously in the budget, which was good news for everyone, bringing that tax down to 10%. I say good news for everyone, probably not the Conservative Party PR department with that howler there. National Lottery. The National Lottery launched in 1994. Within 5 years, admissions in bingo clubs had dropped by about 20%. That competition for that pound really affected all the gaming verticals, really, of the prospect of tens of millions of pounds of jackpots for a few pound a week. And that share of wallet really hit traditional gambling quite hard. And then, of course, you had the rise of online bingo. Now, obviously, this was a huge opportunity, but it was also seen as a big threat to the industry as well. So for all those reasons above, bingo halls dropped, number of UK bingo halls dropped from about 1,400 down to just over 600. And there's probably been a few more closures over the last couple of years. So, and admissions were half that of sort of the 80s, down to 43 million. Now, as I say, from a retail perspective, Mecca and Gala were obviously the, you know, the major players in retail. But online, the competition is far more intense. So you've got, obviously, Mecca and Gala are huge brands in their own right on our Playtech network. But you've got the likes of Foxy, Jackpot Joy, big operators themselves. The Sun Bingo obviously recently announced their move to the Playtech network. And then Tombola, they dominate the market from a player volume perspective. However, there was a shift in the way the players... The number of UK online bingo sites is estimated around 350, which is a huge jump from sort of the mid-2000s when the likes of Foxy, Think Bingo, Cyber Bingo all launched. And bingo revenues have been growing, obviously, year on year quite significantly. This is Playtech Bingo's gross gaming revenue over the last seven years. This is just pure bingo. It's not taking into account any side games, scratch cards or anything like that. But we've achieved over 100 million gross over the last 3 years. When you look back at the product development over this time, it's interesting to see that a lot of the features that we've put into the online product have their roots in retail bingo. Things like syndicates, session bingo, superbooks, all came from clubs. Cash Line was Mecca's big revenue driving interval game that was ported online and made into an online version for Mecca. So what our pros were trying to do in this time was kind of create a familiar environment for retail players to encourage that crossover into online. And desktop bingo, as you can see, was growing very significantly and very successfully year on year. However, what we've seen in the last couple of years is a shift in the way players want to play and how and where they want to interact with our products. I'm talking specifically sort of mobile and tablet. And online's having to adapt to those changing trends. But some of these trends as well are also affecting retail. The rise of slots, for instance, game consumption, mini game consumption, the rise of handheld tablet usage within clubs as well. Has been phenomenal, ask any retail operator. So there is now there's an opportunity for online learnings to be ported into clubs. So what I see, I mean, the evolution of bingo, what I see is it's a product that's on its way to being reconnected. What started out as one sort of very distinct channel, obviously with retail bingo, very successful as we've seen back in the day, then developed into two streams, two channels. Retail, as we've seen, began to struggle in the 1990s, and then online, and latterly mobile, to a lesser extent tablet, has obviously grown in prominence. But I think now retail is at a crossroads, and I think there's a real bright future ahead for retail. The likes of Rebel Bingo is a concept that's gaining popularity, particularly for a younger demographic. Bingo Gods have opened up a unique retail venue recently. Gala are just about to open up a new retail club in Southampton, the first of its kind in 7 years. The Mintel predicts that retail spend and emissions are going to grow over the next 3 years. Spend is due to go up by about 30 million, they predict. And the Caledonia Group certainly shared that optimistic outlook, obviously having purchased the Gala Bingo retail estate last year. The new Gala Club, for instance, focuses heavily on social areas, electronics, handhelds, a lot of slots. And as I say, these are all kind of reflective of the way the players want to play. And I think the first step towards a real omni-channel solution is those handheld devices. And this is where Bingo, Playtech One and the omni-channel approach comes into play. Playtech One has now delivered in the Mecca retail estate. Two of our most popular games online, Adventures in Wonderland, Amazon Wild, are now available to play on the handheld tablets within the clubs. So now players can play, obviously, in the club. They can play on their mobile on their way home. They can play on their tablet or desktop or mobile, and when they get home. And it's not just there's obviously many more titles to follow on the handhelds, but it's not just slots. I mean, looking further ahead, potentially in the future, and regulation permitting, you know, we can see an era where bingo games are being played by the same online players as players in the club as well. So that's when we'll really have a truly connected or reconnected product and a true omni-channel experience. So I'm going to hand over to Gary now, who's going to talk a bit about the evolution and changing trends and players' habits and lifestyles and technology.
Okay, thanks very much, Andrew. Hi, everyone. As Andrew says, we've had our history lesson. I think we can now look at what we might have down the line. So what does the future hold for online gaming, and with a bit of a focus on bingo? So what I've put this under is evolution, not revolution. I think the key here is that as an industry, we tend to always jump on the next product that comes out. I think we always think that's the direction to take. We want to get on it right away. We want to secure the customer's primary activity slot. And what I'm going to try and talk about, and hopefully everyone will start to agree with me as we go through this, is that maybe the key here is that we evolve with this, and we don't necessarily always want to be that primary slot. Maybe there's a lot more opportunities we can have if we accept that we're the secondary activity for our customers without trying to shoehorn something into a device that not only doesn't fit in with the device you're using, but also the habits, the life habits everyone now has in this modern world. So I'm not going to say that new technology is a bad thing. I might come across a bit negative. I think it's all great, the stuff that we've got coming out. But what I think we need to do with this is we need to learn what the players or just the general population is now doing with this technology. How do they interact with this? You know, what has changed fundamentally? So if I go back when smartwatch was all still being discussed, I was actually asked for what can Bingo do on the smartwatch? And you know, we developed a wireframe for it, and we looked at what we could potentially do if this was a direction we want to take. But I would argue that maybe we don't do that. Maybe we just see, what does a customer now do that they've got this watch? How are we going to then put them onto the device that we know we can monetize them on? And just picking on the watch, a few examples there, which hopefully gives some food for thought, is Business Insider UK had done a survey towards the end of last year. And this was asking over 300 smart Apple Watch users how they thought it was and such. And actually over 50% of these people had stopped using it within 2 weeks. And I think one of the top reasons within the top five of why that was, they actually cited that it was an annoying way to tell the time. It was quite ironic. And also you can still win a watch next door, so I don't want to put it down too much. So what I'd say, if we then look at mobile, which has obviously slowly evolved over the years, if we then look at how often we're using the mobile phone to make a phone call, I think we all know now that we're getting our phone out to do almost everything else but make a phone call, with people tending to actually communicate other ways. But I think what we learn from that is that rather than us putting something on the watch or anything like that, we know what they're doing with their phone, they're always going to be using it. And to expand a bit more on the phone, 80% of smartphone users have their phone on them for all but 2 hours of the day. So this is something that's constantly on them, so we know that they're always going to be able to get out of that device rather than trying to get them to do something else. We've got more time after this. You can come up and talk to me about how tablet, and I think that actually affected that tablet didn't take off the way that everyone had envisioned. But moving on to the when, where, what. So this is when I say it's key, when we need to know people's lifestyle habits because of this new technology. So the when, ultimately, as I said, given the phone's proximity to all of our customers or potential customers, the when is any time. I think we've all been sitting here, and I'm glad that I've not seen anyone do it now, but people will sit and quite happy get out their phone for a few minutes, you know, here or there. Maybe they're on a break, or maybe they're actually sitting watching television and such. What I'm just saying is that people are quite comfortable to engage in these short bursts, and that we can also get customers to use that to engage with our products if they're built with this in mind, rather than us trying to get a customer to stay on it for a while. And when we started looking at customers doing this, we've seen some KPIs that people started to get a bit concerned about. And I would say that one that's relevant here is the session length. So we have said that session length has, we've been trying to, well, other, you know, the industry as a whole is trying to increase that. The idea being that these short sessions aren't as profitable. And while it is true, if a customer's on longer, we should be able to monetize them at a lot greater extent. But perhaps that's not what we're able to do. I've just said that this is a short break. Normally it's got a hard stop. So if we're trying to get a customer to play longer, maybe the game's more complex. Maybe it's got something in there that takes a lot longer understanding. The customer will likely disengage with that product. An industry we can learn from here is the retail industry, which in the UK has estimated they lose £6 billion in abandoned transactions. And that's across 50% of the general customer base. So this isn't just random fact that I'm using to hopefully prove a point. It's generally just to say that it doesn't matter what you've got there. It could be the best game that we've ever got, one of Playtech's games. But if it's not designed for what the customer wants to do with it, then they will abandon that as well. So moving on to the where. There's a lot of examples here to show maybe what people might say is limitations for us. But I'd say there's actually opportunities here if we look at it at the right angle. So that first one there, what we've coined the static mobile. I'm hoping we're the first to coin that, trademark pending. This is a customer that's sitting at home, watching TV, doing whatever. Again, just getting out their phone. I've already said how often it's around them. But another fact to know here is that 3 out of 4 smartphone users are checking their phones 34 times a day. So I'm not saying that they could be gambling 34 times a day, but we're always talking about wallet share. And I think wallet share we've always looked at as a way of getting more money and looking at the wallet as all the gaming sites can go to. But the wallet could actually be time. So perhaps a player just wants to have an interaction of some kind for a few minutes to alleviate boredom, waiting on a train and so on and so forth. So if they're comfortable to gamble and such, then they will come to your product if they know they can actually have some sort of entertainment and a short burst of time. Another one there in bed. They actually, we believe that customers, I think most of the smartphone users that wake up, is they're checking their phone within first 50 minutes of waking up. Again, I'm not saying as soon as they wake up they'll gamble. Probably that'd be a problem, actually. But the idea is that they're constantly engaging with this phone for little bursts of time. So this is coming on to the key point and bringing us back to Bingo, the what. What we want these customers to play is ultimately what they're going to enjoy for the device they're using or the time that they've got. So those first couple of slots there, which two of which you can demo and understand. When we were first designing these, the idea was we targeted the KPI of session length. Again, we were back in the time when we thought, let's extend that session length, generate more revenues. By the time this launched, obviously a lot had changed. The mobile market had grown massively for us. You know, we're talking about upwards of 70% of new registrations are coming in on this device. So again, I'm saying this is evolution, not revolution. So it's not that we've said they're going to increase the session length. We're still allowing those kind of customers who tend to be your high value players can play for longer. What we've done is made this game very clear to the player how long they've got before they get a sort of reward or a bonus. Again, you can demo on the stand, but broadly speaking, you'll see the screenshot of Chocolate Munch on the top left there is showing at the top right of that icon an amount of layers of a chocolate bar. Keep in mind, this is for a Bingo player base. I know it looks very, very soft. But what this shows is that a customer will be able to know how long they've got left before they've cleared every layer. And a layer is cleared as they've got a winning line on the first chocolate bar. We built this with an aim of getting it about every 20 minutes you get through it from start to finish. And we actually found when we checked the figures that this session length on this game is, on average, 20 minutes. So what this has done now, and that's the third highest on our network. So we've actually built a game that ticked that box. Going back to these new players we're saying, is that by being so transparent with it and being clear to the customer, they'll know that if they've got a 10-minute spot to play something, and they play this game for 10 minutes, it'll be very clear how far they are along the road. So if they've got another 10 minutes, they'll more likely come to this game because they want to complete it. And that's the hope, that we don't want to put a game where it's the kind of complexity of the math model is very volatile. They want them to come back and play for longer. We've just shown them that the game's there, they can play for that short burst and come back. Moving on to our latest Bingo game, because we obviously keep in mind that Bingo has a much higher margin than a slot. And we know that the slot revenues is obviously a key part of any Bingo business. But the idea of that could be based on the fact that Bingo traditionally, being a 7-minute game, had a lot of time in between. again, thinking back to when you're at home, static mobile, you're watching TV, doing something else. So while they're playing their bingo game, they're doing that other secondary activity. So what we've tried to develop is a game that actually is bringing it a lot closer to a kind of slot type game. Much quicker, much more focused on a mobile player who's coming in, they've got a short burst of time, and they can enjoy this game, and it actually should only take 1 minute. What we have built in, again, because we're trying to evolve with this new customer base, we don't want to alienate everyone, is we've put in an inbuilt retention tool. Again, this is based on collecting. It's kind of similar to what I've mentioned about the slots. So the customer will know exactly how long it will take before they can trigger a bonus that we have built into this game. For this, we've used the same kind of thinking. We hope they can do it in about a 20-minute session, so it should excuse me. It should please those customers who want to do a longer session. But for the guys who have a short session, they know when they come back, they can trigger that bonus in exactly the amount of time that they know. This is what's actually on everyone's seats. I'm glad if no one opened it all at the same time, because it's actually quite loud. Well, not as loud as that, to be fair. So bottom line, what I'm saying here is that this innovation will ultimately lead to monetization. We don't need to be shoehorning our product in, potentially alienating all our customers by giving them something that they don't actually want. They want to have something that they can do as a secondary activity. We don't need to be that primary activity. We can be quite happy sitting there as that second one. As long as my player, who traditionally had a 30, 40 minute session, is now going to have 4 or 5 of these 10 minute sessions. Excuse me, getting over a sore throat actually. So this is what we're hoping to see. Hopefully I should show a short video of a few of our games. As you can tell from the stand in the video, we spare no expense on these sort of things. So to kind of bring this together and to see how it ties up to what Andrew had said, we have seen a good journey between how retail is fed into online, and we can actually then feed this back into retail. It might seem that it's too far apart, but I'm not talking about the products. It's not necessarily the products that have to go into that retail. It could be just the learnings that we've got. I've said about bingo being a secondary activity. These newer clubs are actually following that sort of mindset. You can have a sealed off area. It's like a bar. It's a lot louder with music and such, and you can have bingo playing in the background. So we can quite happily go to the retail industry and show them how they So we can go to the retail industry with the things we've learned, not just a product that they can see everywhere, but it's also how they interact with the game can be very different. So the idea being that this year, we can hopefully aim for this Playtech One solution that we're aiming for, a true omnichannel experience that goes beyond just a product. It goes towards a customer and player, potential player's mentality and such. So that's it. We've got, like I say, you've got the box there to show you how Cash Cubes works. You can demo these slots on our stand, our business cards on the back wall, and we'll obviously be around for some questions if anyone wants. So thank you very much for your time. I'll pass you back over to David.